Over the last 2-3 years, we have seen a rise in research involving deep learning methods in the field of bioinformatics and computational biology. This is mostly due to the remarkable success these methods have shown in these areas. Today, we will be looking into what these deep learning algorithms are and what all their architectures are available. So, let us start with the first method, which is artificial neural network. But before we talk about artificial neural network, let's see how a biological neural network functions. Our brain is very good at finding patterns, and to do that, we do not think about equations or complex rules. We do not even think of linearity or non-linearity to begin with. The image we see of a cat, we directly see that it's a cat or it's a dog. We work at very implicit level. Our brain is a complex structure built of large number of small processing units, which is neurons. So let us see what this neuron is made up of. So for our purpose, let us say the neuron consists of three parts. The dendrite, which is a branch-like structure, it collects the inputs from other neurons. Next is the cell body, where these inputs are collected and an action potential is established. And once this action potential is established, it is carried forward via axon and transmitted to other neurons with help of axon terminals. If you want to create an artificial neuron, we would need dendrite to collect input, the cell body to process it, and establish the activity and axon to carry this activity as output. So the rough architecture will be as in the below image. And the working of this neuron will be something like the dendrite will collect the input signals which are taken to cell body. In the cell body, the inputs are weighted summed, and based on the activation function, the activity level will be established. And this activity is then carried forward as an output via axon. With this small system that we created right now is what is called a perceptron. It takes an input based on the weights and the activation function, it produces some activity and then passes out that activity as an output. The notation we are using here is a matrix notation. It is a bit different from the earlier notation which we have used for, which was the weighted sum notation, but the things that both of these represent is the same. The brief history about the perceptron. It was developed by Frank Rosenblatt in 1958 at Cornell Aeronautics Lab. It was intended to be a machine rather than a program that we see it nowadays. And the machine was actually designed for image recognition. And the activation which they used was a simple step function, which means if the weighted sum is greater than a threshold, the output would be true. And if that weighted sum is below the threshold, the output would be zero. However, in 1969, Marvin Minsky and Seymour Papert showed that a single perceptron network is incapable of learning an XOR function. Well, an XOR function, as seen in the right image, is a binary input function. So it takes two inputs and the output is positive if both inputs are different, and the output is negative if both inputs are same. The problem here is that the examples belonging to the same class are on the diagonals, and even if we draw multiple decision lines, as we can see in this image, that none of these single lines individually are capable of separating out these classes, and this caused a huge problem because no matter where the decision boundary lies, it will never be able to satisfactorily divide the classes apart. So this incapability of single perceptron led to the development of multi-layer perceptron. So This multi-layer perceptron is where a multiple perceptrons are interconnected in form of layers. So it is a type of neural network. As we can see in the below image. And these type of neural networks are further popularized in 1989 by a paper published by David Rummelhart, Jeffrey Hinton, and Ronald Williams. Before we go any further, let's briefly talk about what the architecture of a typical neural network or this multilayer perceptron is. So on the leftmost side, we have the input neurons or the input layer, which will pass on the input features into our network. And on the rightmost part, we have the output layer, which comprises of output neurons. These corresponds to the number of outputs we have for our data. And in between, we have multiple layers. And in these multiple layers, we can have multiple number of neurons. And all these layers are where the input is going in and is getting multiplied by the weights. These middle layers are called hidden layers, and their corresponding neurons are called hidden neurons. So let us now imagine that our multilayer perceptron has only a linear function, and we propagate our input through our network, which means the inputs are multiplied with the weights to get the activities of the hidden neurons, and these activities of these hidden neurons are further multiplied with another set of weights to get the output. So in the end, by doing all the calculations, and in the end, we will get an output which is still a weighted sum of our inputs. As we can see now, that's g1x1 plus g2x2. The final equation we got is still a linear function. And even if we add more neurons or even more layers, it will still be useless, because the output is still going to be linear. And this output is not going to change until unless we add some kind of non-linearity to our neurons. And to add this non-linearity, the best way to do this to have a non-linear function for the activation. Now, some examples of a well-known activation functions are sigmoid, which has a range of 0 and 1. Another example is 10H, which has a range between minus 1 and 1. And the most popular these days is ReLU, which has a range from 0 to infinity, which means it just keeps the positive part of the activity. So when we incorporate a nonlinear activation to our network, it is believed that a neural network can be treated as a universal function approximator, which can approximate any function possible given the sufficient number of neurons and sufficient number of layers are present in the network. So till now we have seen that our network is able to propagate our input through the network by multiplying them with weights. But we still need to figure out what this optimal weight should be so that we get the best outcome required. So this is done using back propagation. So let's see how this back propagation works. So the process starts with the inputs. From here, these inputs are multiplied with the weights to get the activities of the hidden neurons, which then pass through an activation function, and then again multiplied with another set of weights to get the output. And as we know, this neural network is a part of supervised learning method. So we already know the target values or the actual values. So the error is calculated using the output of the network and the actual values. And this error is then back propagated layer by layer. And based on this error, the weights are updated iteratively using gradient descent. Gradient descent is a way of optimizing the loss function. In this, the loss function is basically the error that we want to minimize, and the parameters that we want to optimize for are the weights of these networks. So how does this work? So for the gradient descent, the weights will be updated as the first equation given here. So the new weights will be the old weights minus an alpha times the small change in the weights. And the alpha here is the learning rate, which will define how fast or how slow we move in the direction toward our new weight. And also the delta is defined by the partial derivative of the error with respect to the weight for which we are optimizing. There is one more thing that should be remembered while doing the backpropagation, and that is the updation of the weights which are directly going into the output neuron. For those weights, the updation is only dependent on the output or the error of that or of the neuron into which though that particular weight is going into. However, if we go further back into the network, those errors or those weights are contributing to all of the output, and therefore the updation of those weights will also be governed by error of all the neurons, of all the output neurons. So let's look at convolution neural networks. So we have seen that artificial neural networks are very effective for structured and tabulated data, but they are very ineffective when the data becomes unstructured. And a lot of data and large amount of data available in the real world is of unstructured and untabulated type. So this may include a lot of images or a lot of text. So these images can be converted to tabular data easily using unfolding method. So unfolding means that we'll take each row of our image and we concatenate them together to form a huge vector. And each pixel of our image will correspond to an input feature for our artificial neural network. But the problem with unfolding is that it causes our feature space to become extremely high dimensional. And it also does not scale very well for high resolution images or even colored images. For example, if we have a 100 x 100 image, that itself will lead to a feature space of 10,000. And if we increase the resolution of our image, this feature space will keep on increasing. And to accommodate for this huge number of feature space, we need to add more number of hidden layers to get accurate classification or to extract a useful pattern from these images. So one of the biggest problems of unfolding is the loss of spatial structure and breaking of local patterns. So this is very evident from the image that we see on the right hand side, where on top we have a matrix representation of number 1. Here the features and overall structure of the digit is very evident. But when we unfold it to form a vector, we cannot see any features, or the number digit is not recognizable. So similar thing happened for neural network as well. So it is not able to figure out or extract the useful information out of this vector. To overcome this problem, Kunihiko Fukushima introduced neocognitron in 1980. So it introduced two important layers into the artificial neural network, which led to convolution neural network. And these two layers were convolution layer and downsampling layer. So using these two layers, we were able to preserve the spatial structure and also the local pattern. This method was further popularized by Jan LeCun through his paper in 1989, which used backpropagation to learn the weights, and this formed the foundation of our modern computer vision. So before we dive deeper into the convolution layer or convolution neural network, let's briefly talk about what the convolution operation itself is. So convolution operation is a mathematical operation where we take a moving dot product of our input image with a filter or a kernel. So this kernel or filter is a small spatial grid which have certain values into it. So we use this convolution to extract the features from our image. And using this convolution, the relation between the pixels are preserved. And what happens during this operation is the small square, which is our filter, actually look at the smaller regions of our image and it learns those local patterns. The output size from the convolution operation is dependent on stride, padding, filter size, and input size. So the filter size and input size is basically our image size, and the filter size is how big the filters need to be. So let's talk about what the stride is. It's basically when we are doing the moving dot product of our input image with our filter, that how many number of pixels our filter moves at a time is the stride. So for example, in the top image, if our filter is moving every one pixel at a time, so our stride will be one. And stride of two means that the filter will jump two pixels at a time, which can be seen from the example in below image, where the start of the green and start of the red is two pixels apart. So the higher the value of stride is, the smaller the output size will be, because it is compressing our image even more. So the next part is the padding. Padding is the number of layers of zeros we add at each dimension, to the each dimension of our image, is what's called the padding. So this is done to control the spatial size of the output. So let's say if we want to maintain the input and output from our convolution, we can add these layers of zeros to the both dimensions, and we can preserve the spatial dimensions. We can actually, using the stride, the padding size, and the input and filter dimensions, we can actually calculate what the output size of our image will be. And it can be calculated using the formula, which is given over here, which is W minus F plus 2P divided by S and whole plus 1. In this, W is corresponding to our image shape in each dimension. F corresponds to the filter shape in that particular dimension. P is for padding and in that dimension, and S is stride in that dimension. So for example, if we have an input image which is of 3x3 as seen on the left hand side, and we have padded it with 0 in both dimensions. So in this case, our W is equals to 3 and padding is equals to 1. And we have selected a filter to be of size 0, of size filter to be of size 3, and stride to be of 1 pixel. So if we input these values into a formula, we get that the output of our image is actually 3x3. And we can see how the zero padding is able to preserve both input and output dimension. So even if we have the input of 3x3, our output is still maintained to be 3x3. So now that we have seen what the convolution operation is, let's look into what convolution layer is. So convolution layer is a core building block of our convolution neural network. So it consists of many filters stacked together, and each of this filter extends to the depth of our input value, which means if we have colored image, so color image will have three channels. So our filter will also have three channels, and each channel will correspond to one channel of our input image. So similarly, we can see that our filter will also become a three-dimensional representation. But now, since we have multiple filters and each filter is actually doing a convolution over the same image. So at the end, what we will get is, we will get multiple features, multiple outputs from our convolution operation. For example, let's say we have an image which has three channels, and we have two filters, which is W0 and W1. Each of the filter is a three-dimensional representation or a three-dimensional matrix. And when we do
this when we apply these filters on our on the input image, we will get two output we get two output feature maps,
and the values for each of these filters is learned via backpropagation.
The single convolution layer can have multiple filters. So based on these multiple filters, we can see that the output dimension is also a three dimension. That's why it is called an output volume. And the first two dimensions of this feature map will correspond to the output width and height. And the third dimension will correspond to how many filters there were in the convolution layer. So next comes the activation layer. So every element of the feature map which comes out of the convolution layer is now passed through the activation function. And we use this activation to introduce the non-linearity into our convolution layer. So to apply this non-linearity, so any of the activation function can be used, but ReLU is often preferred to other functions. So if we apply ReLU to the layer, so what happens? It keeps the positive part as it is, but it brings the negative values to the zero. So as we can see from the image, the first column of the first row, which is 15, is preserved as it is, but the minus 10 in the first row is brought to zero. So ReLU is very simple activation function, but the beauty of ReLU is that it makes the learning faster. So after activation function or the activation layer comes the pooling layer. In the pooling, what we do is we do the downsampling or the feature volume that is come out of the convolution and activation layer. So what happens now is that our feature map is divided into small non-overlapping rectangular sub-regions, and features in each of the sub-regions are independently downsampled to a single value. So how it is done is, let's take an example of one particular feature map. So as we can see on the bottom image on the right hand side, so we have a 4x4 image. We have divided this into 2x2 sized subregions. So and this each subregion is given by the color red, green, yellow and blue. And for all the and for each of these subregion, we are actually taking one value out of it. This downsampling also introduced a non-linearity to our convolution neural network. Some of the common ways of doing downsampling is by taking average of each subregions. And the second most common way is the max pooling, where we take the maximum value of each subregion. So in modern CNNs, max pooling is often used, as we can also see from the same image that from the each region, the maximum value is actually propagated further. The benefit of this pooling layer is that it reduces the spatial size of the representation, and it also helps in reduction of the parameters that need to be trained. And using this, what happens, the amount of computation in the network also reduces. So another benefit of this pooling operation is that it helps in controlling overfitting. And the most important characteristic of this pooling layer is that it helps make our model more translational invariance. So translation invariance means that no matter where a particular feature is present in our image, our model will be able to recognize that equally. So for example, we can see there is a chess piece on the top left part in the first image and on the bottom right part of the second image. Even though it is the same chess piece at different position, our model will be able to recognize them equally well. So once we have extracted all of our features, we need a mechanism to actually pass it on and get some decision out of it. It can be a classification or a regression. So how we will pass this output volume to our neural network? So this is actually done by fully connected layer. So fully connected layer is nothing but our dense neural network layers, where all neurons from the previous layer are connected to the current layer. So how we achieve this is we actually flatten our feature volume into a huge vector, and this vector is then passed on to the fully connected layers to make the final prediction. And once we have done all these operations, we get the final activation, final architecture of our convolution neural network, which looks similar to the image on this slide. So here we have our input image, which is an image of a scenery. This is passed on to a convolution and ReLU operation to give us a feature map. And these feature maps are then passed through a pooling operation, which will reduce the size of these feature maps. And this whole convolution, ReLU, and pooling operation can be applied multiple times. And after all this operation, and after the repeated operations, we get the feature map, which we flatten out and pass it to a fully connected layer to give the output classification. Let's look one more type of deep learning method, which is recurrent neural network. Yeah, before we go into what recurrent neural networks are, let us do a thought experiment. Let us imagine that there is a ball rolling across the floor, and you are given the snapshot of the ball at time equals to t0, and you are asked to predict where this ball will be after 5 seconds. Your guess at this point will be as random, because we don't know what's the direction of the ball, what's the speed of the ball, and from where this ball has been coming. So, but now, let's say we have been given the snapshots of this ball at every 1 second interval. So now we have the snapshots of the same ball at time equals to 0, 1, 2, 3, and 4. And now we are asked at what position this ball will be at time 5. So this becomes very easy, because we now know where this ball is coming from, what's the direction, and what's the speed of this ball. So this forms a type of sequential data, where the output at next steps requires the knowledge of previous steps. The textual and audio data are excellent examples of this category. So where in textual data, that every word that comes next depends on the previous word. And in this type of data, rearrangement often breaks the context, and the data no longer makes sense. For example, let's take a sentence, I am going to school. And now if we rearrange the words into it, so it becomes I to school going am. So the second sentence no longer makes any sense. So a basic ANN works on an assumption that the input examples are independent and they are not related to each other. And so because of this assumption, ANN performs very badly if this assumption is invalidated. But there is a lot of work done on the sequential data. For example, we have voice assistants where we talk something and we get a response out of it. We have text to speech where we type something and we get speech out of it. And even Google Translate, where we can translate from one language to another language. And even nowadays, Google has released a Smart Compose where it completes a sentence based on what we have written previously. Before moving forward, let's do one more experiment. Let's try to recite all the alphabets. It's easy, right? Because we have memorized all these alphabets in a particular sequence. So now if we are asked to recite these alphabets backward, it's not so easy anymore, because we have never memorized or we have never tried to recite them backward. Or even if we are asked, what is the third letter after J? That becomes an even challenging problem, because we have never learned these alphabets in their positions or in their absolute positions. This happens because our brain has been trained to recite the alphabets in a particular sequence. And whenever we are asked to do opposite of that, or whenever we are asked to get the absolute location or absolute position of our alphabets, we are not able to recollect them immediately. So this happens because our brain uses sequential memory to store such things, where we are actually memorizing everything in a sequence.
Vainer memory.
Whenever we see something progressing in time and space, we always remember them as a sequence. For example, if we see a movie or we hear some music, we always remember them as a sequence of progressing movie scenes or progressing lyrics. We never remember them as what word is at what place in the lyrics or at which time step a particular movie scenes occur. So RNNs are very efficient in handling such kind of sequential data, and this is mostly because it tries to replicate the concept of sequential memory. It maintains the information from previous states to next state. So let us see how this happens. To get a feel of it, let's start with a simple feedforward network, which has input layer, hidden layer, output layer. And RNN implements the sequential memory by using previous information for later computation. So how this can be done? So this can be easily implemented by creating a loop within this simple feedforward network, or the output from the hidden layer is again given back to the hidden layer of next step. So this creates a highway for our information to pass on from one step to another. This passed information is called hidden state. So this looping mechanism is much more clearly understood by unrolling the RNN. By unrolling the RNN, we mean that we write down our network for the complete sequence. So for example of the below image, we can see we have a rolled RNN on the left hand side, and we have its corresponding unrolled RNN on the right hand side. So the unrolled RNN, in the unrolled RNN, we can see that the input is going to the hidden layer, producing an output. And for the next step, the output from the hidden layer, from the previous hidden layer, is also passed along with the new input to produce the output. So let us see an example for this thing. So consider we are given a sentence. What time is it? Since this sentence will be fed to RNN, our words will be an individual entity on their own. So which will be what time is it and question mark. So question mark is also an important character because it signifies the termination, and it also signifies that the sentence is a questionary sentence. So first, what will be fed to the RNN, and it will produce an output. Next, the next word time will be fed along with the hidden state from its previous step. And this is carried on for all the words in the sentence. Therefore, by the final step, RNN has encoded information of all the words, and the output O5 is produced.
So once we have encoded all this information, so we need to make some sense out of it.
Now what happens is we actually pass this encoded information or the output of our final step through a fully connected layer. And this fully connected layer is nothing but a dense neural network, which corresponds to our artificial neural network setup. All the neurons from the previous layers are connected to the neurons in next layer. So the major drawback of RNN is what's called the short-term memory. Or let's take final step of our previous example. In this thing, we can see the hidden state has different colors, and each of this color corresponds to the amount of information that is captured by this hidden layer is reducing. And after a certain point of time, it will happen that the first step information will become almost non-existential. This happens because of vanishing gradient, that a gradient becomes so small that it stops updating the information.
Well, a typical recurrent unit will accumulate input and previous hidden state, pass it through an activation function. From there, this result is branched off, first toward the output and another toward recurrent unit at next step. Let us now see how this backpropagation works in recurrent neural network. But before we get into that, let's look at the example structure we have for a neural net, for the recurrent neural network. In this architecture, we have three recurrent units with three inputs, x1, x2, and x3. We also, we have three hidden states, s1, s2, and s3, and we have three outputs, y1, y2, y3. The weight ws is for the hidden states, wy is for hidden state to output, and wx is for input to hidden state. For any given time t, we have two equations, one for hidden states and another for the output. Here the g1 and g2 are the activation functions. Let us use the squared error as an error function. Therefore, at time t equals to 3, the error will be the squared of the difference between actual output minus the output from the recurrent network. For updating the weights by w, let us consider the representation on the right of the slide. So the weights are updated using gradient descent. The updation rule is given by the formula new w is equals to old w minus alpha times partial derivative of error at time 3 divided by w of y. And the partial derivative of error with respect to weight is given by below equation. So here, error at time 3 is a function of y output at time 3. Hence, we have differentiated the error with respect to y3. But y3 is also a function of wy. Hence, we have differentiated y3 with respect to wy. Moving on to adjusting weights for the hidden states, that is ws. For this, let us consider the representation on the right. So here, the output or the error is a function of y3. Hence, error is differentiated with respect to y3. Also, the y3, which is the output, is a function of s3, which is hidden state of third step. Hence, this output at third step is differentiated with respect to hidden state at this step. Further, the s3 is a function of ws. Hence, this s3 is differentiated with respect to ws. But this is not all. We need to also take into consideration the previous time steps. So we will partially differentiate the error function with respect to the recurrent units or the hidden states s2 and also s1 with consideration of their corresponding weight matrix ws. And lastly, for updation of wx, which is weights for the input function, here the output is function of y3. Therefore, it is first differentiated with respect to y3, then y3 is differentiated with respect to s3 because it is function of s3, and s3 is also function of wx. Therefore, it is differentiated with respect to wx. Similar to previous slide where we have seen how for updation of ws we need to take into consideration the hidden states s2 and s1. Similarly here also, for updating weights wx, we need to take hidden states s2 and s1 also in consideration. Hence, the resultant partial derivative of error with respect to the weights is as given on the slide. Using these equations, we can now backpropagate the error and update the weights. And over the iterations, our neural net or our recurrent neural network will get trained for minimizing the error. So let's summarize what recurrent neural networks are. So these are a type of artificial neural network where connection between the nodes form a directed graph along the temporal sequence. So this allows it to exhibit temporal dynamic behavior. And here the output at a next time steps depends on the computation at previous time step. recurrent neural networks perform much better at sequential data, and this is generally because of the concept of sequential memory, which they try to replicate.
So we have seen till now that how deep learning algorithm can process text. Now let us see how we can represent the text before that the machine can understand them. We human beings communicate in text. We communicate using our languages, but machines, they understand only numbers. So we need a method to encode the text into a number representation. And this numeric representation needs to be done in a way that no two texts have same representation. Each text should have its own unique representation. Now let us look at some of the methods which can be used to encode the text. So the first method is one-hot encoding. So this, in this method, we encode a word or sentence in a binary vector representing the presence or absence of that particular word or sentence. So for example, let us say we have 10,000 words. So our representation vector will be of dimension 10,000. And to encode our sentence, we will put one at the position corresponding to the words present in our sentence. The drawbacks of this method is that the encoded dimension have very, very huge dimension, and also the numeric representation is very sparse. So as we can see, even though we have total of 10,000 words, for each vector, only few of them have one, rest all will be zeros. Another method is using term frequency. So this is also similar to using one-hot encoding, but the difference is that instead of putting one and zero for presence or absence, we will put how many times a word has occurred in total word list. So this also have drawbacks similar to one-hot encoding, which were huge vector dimensions and also a sparse numeric representation.
So another interesting method is using singular value decomposition. In this, we decompose our co-occurrence matrix, and this decomposition gives a low dimension representation of each word. So the drawback of this method is that the singular value decomposition is computationally costly. So we can see it has a complexity of mn square. And it also, since we are decomposing the co-occurrence matrix, and this co-occurrence matrix is symmetric, it doesn't consider in what order the words occur.
So all of these methods we saw, they have their own drawbacks. So the big question still persists, that how can we build a simple and scalable model that is fast to train, which can run over billions of words and produce an exceedingly good word representation?
So let us see a model which tries to answer this question as closely as possible. And this model is Word2Vec. So Word2Vec is a group of models which represents each word in a lower dimension vector, and it tries to derive the relation between word and its contextual word. The key idea behind is to predict the surrounding words of every word, and in doing that, it is able to capture the relations in an algebraic representation.
So in Word2Vec model, we select the window for a sentence, and the center word of the window is the focus word, and rest of the words are the context word. So for example, let us take the sentence, the quick brown fox jumps over the lazy dog. In this, we will select the window of size 5. So we will start with the center at the first word. So our focus word will be the, and quick and brown will be the context word. So our training sample, or the pairs we will get, are the and quick and the brown. So in the next step, we will move our window one word forward. Now the focus word is quick, and the brown fox will be the context word. And now our pair would be quick the, quick brown, and quick fox. And similarly, we will do this for a complete sentence. So at the end, we will get these pairs of focus word and the context word. And these will form the basis of getting the embedding vectors. There are two important types of model in Word2Vec family, and these are skip cram, and continuous backward, short CBOM. And both of these models are single hidden layer neural net, artificial neural network. That means they have only one hidden layer in between the output and input. In skip cram model, given the focus word, we try to predict what the context word will be. So the input will be one hot vector in which there will be one only at the position of the focus word, and the output will be the probabilities of each word in the corpus to be the contextual word for that focus word. Now the question is, from where do we get the embedding vectors? So once our model is completely trained and we are able to satisfactorily get the context words for every focus word, so all of our weights are optimally tuned. So if we have 10,000 words in our corpus as an input vector and 300 neurons in the hidden layer, we will get a weight matrix which is of size 10,000 cross 300 for the hidden layer. And this hidden layer is corresponding to our weight vector. And each of these row of this weight matrix is corresponding to an embedding vector of size 300 for each of the focus words. The continuous bag of words model is just inverse of skip cram model, in which given the contextual words, we try to predict the focus word. In this, the input is the one hot encoded vectors of our contextual words, and the output is the probability of each word in the corpus being the focus word. The word embeddings created using word-to-vec model are able to capture the relationship between the words so effectively that if we find the cosine similarity between the vectors, these similarities, they will directly correlate with the similarities within the words. For example, the similarity between the verbs walking and walked is captured by the similarity between the vector representations of the word walking and walked. And similarly, the relationship between the countries and the capital is also captured very well by the similarity between the representations of the word for the country and the word for their capital. Since these vector representations are able to capture the relationship so well, we can even do the algebraic operations with these words now. So for example, if we take the vector representation of king, and from that if we subtract the vector representation of man, and to the result we add the vector representation of woman, the final vector which we will get, that will be equal to the vector representation for the word queen. So this in sense is actually capturing the essence that if we subtract man from the king, we get the authority, and if we add that authority to the woman, we get the word queen. To summarize everything on word-to-vec, we can say that it is faster to train because the vector representation is generated via backpropagation and gradient descent. The word representation generated is in the lower dimensional space. The word-to-vec model is able to capture relationship among the words with algebraic precision, and it is also capable of deriving relationship between the focus word and the words with which it generally occurs around.